Hey, Frank, one quick thing. I'm the program to the industry.
Let me say good morning to everyone, and we are going to begin our auditorium class this morning. I know it's great to be back together again, great to see so many familiar and faces, people we love so much. It's good to be back together again, so it's good to visit and be together. The encouragement from it is, from times like this, it's hard to calculate. This morning we're going to be talking about what Jesus had to say about discipleship, or we're going to be talking a lot about how we're to be salt and light in this world. And so I know we're in a large room, and so but I do believe this. I think that a lot of you have some salt to add to our lesson this morning. So if you feel, if you have a comment to make or a question to ask, we'd love to hear it. I can repeat it for others to hear, but I'm certain that there'll be things that I ought to say or mention that I will forget. So if you've got a point to make and want to chip in, don't let the size of the room hold you back. We'll certainly include you in our lesson today. Let's pray together. Father, we're grateful for this time to study your word, and we're grateful for the impact it has on our lives if we'll just allow it to enter our hearts. We know that it's powerful. It's like a two-edged sword. It can pierce our heart in a way no other words can, and we're grateful for this blessing. Help us now as we study together to learn the message you want us to learn. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so we're going to talk about discipleship today and what Jesus had to say about discipleship. A lot of this comes from the Sermon on the Mount. What a great three or four chapters of lessons to try to grasp and try to incorporate that in our Christian life. What a challenge it is to include that. But that sermon kind of sets the tone for the way we live our Christian lives. You know, Matthew 6 33, seek ye first the kingdom of God. How important a statement that is. And so to be a disciple means that our lives are transformed in the way that we think and the renewing of our minds, our words, our actions. They're to be transformed. And not only that, as we're salt and light, we're supposed to be trying to help others transform their lives as well. And so that is our challenge as we live the Christian life, to be salt and light, help ourselves to remain faithful and help others to understand what God has for them. We strive not to be caught up in worldly things, but that's always a temptation, something we always have to watch. In the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus basically calls us to three very, very broad and high standards, high bars to as Christians for us to achieve with his help. He wants us to be exemplary. Now, by exemplary, what we mean is we're to live holy lives. We should not look like the rest of the world. We're purposefully supposed to look different. And so that's why in Romans 12 it says we're to present our bodies as living sacrifices. And we do this in view of God's mercy. Our lives become living sacrifices. We're to live a life that is set apart. In verse 2 of Romans 12, it says, don't be conformed to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And so what God has to say, prayer, so important in the renewing of our minds and being transformed. And finally, he asks us to be humble, you know, not to be haughty or be like the Pharisees who thought they were so much holier than the other people, but to show our humility to all men, as it mentions in Titus, the third chapter. You know, when I teach a lesson, I'm probably sometimes, I don't know if it's possible to be guilty of this, but you were talking about salt and light. I like to pepper in a lot of scripture with my lessons. It's just God's word is so much more powerful than anything I've got to say. So I like to throw in a lot of scripture as we go along. So we're going to look at Matthew 5, verses 13 through 16, and talking about salt and light. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. So God expects us to be salt in the world. You know, my diet is not great. And I, even when I eat vegetables, here's the terrible, you're supposed to eat vegetables, right? That's healthy eating. Well, of course, what do I want to do? I want to put salt on the vegetables. That's real helpful, you know. So, but salt, it tastes so good, but it has an impact on our taste buds. You know, I really enjoy it. I really like it. And so when we're to be salt in this world, we're supposed to be an influencer. We're trying to influence others for good. To be just like that salt is an influence to our taste buds, we're trying to be salt and influence in the world to the people around us. In verses 14 and 15, it says, you are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everything in the house. So we're to be a light in the world as well. We're supposed to be that lamp on a lampstand that people can see. Or as you've traveled, you've seen that city of lights on the hill in the distance that maybe you're traveling to. So it's symbolic of what God wants us to be in this world, a light in the world, an influencer for God in this world. And in verse 16, he says, in the same way, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. You know, perhaps that summarizes it the best of all. We can talk about, we can try to talk to others about the Lord, but there's nothing like putting a sermon or putting your words into action that carries such volume to other people. It really gets their attention. You know, Ephesians 2 says we were saved by grace, but we were saved by grace to become God's workmanship. You know, we're set aside to do good works to honor the Lord and glorify Him. So if you feel uncomfortable maybe talking with others about the Lord, maybe you're a little shy about doing that, if the words won't do it, let your actions do it. People may understand your actions far better anyway. Acts of kindness and goodness and helpfulness be the example that you ought to be. This is how we can be a light for the Lord. These scriptures also talk about us being salt in the world as well. We live in a society that is the culture is kind of rotting around us. And of course, we know that in older times, when we didn't have refrigeration, salt was a way of preserving food. So part of our job is being salt in this world. We're trying to preserve a world that is rotting right before our very eyes. In Galatians 5, it talks about the sinful nature of man, and it's obvious. And there's a list of these sins that are common. sexual immorality, impurity, debauchery, idolatry, hatred, discord, jealousy, selfish ambition, factions, envy, drunkenness. It is a description of the world in which we live. It was a description of the world in Bible times, and as long as Satan continues, his activeness, it's probably going to be true of our society in the future. Hopefully not. Maybe we can influence it to be better. But it's just a part of the sinful nature of man that we're battling against. And so how can we be salt to a decaying world? How can we help preserve it? Well, we turn around and look in Galatians at the fruits of the Spirit. This is how we can be the salt, the influencer in the world that we want to be. We can display the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace. Can you imagine what an influence we can be as Christians? We're at peace with God. We know that no matter what happens, our home in heaven, it is secure. God will, that's where we're going to, as Christians, that's our ultimate goal, our ultimate destination, our ultimate home. So in a world of turmoil, how appealing will it be to others if we're at peace? Yes, the world, it may be rotting around us. It may stink sometimes, but we're at peace. We know what ultimately is going to be our reward and where we're going to be, so we're at peace about it. Patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Self-control another. If we just display self-control as Christians, what an influence we can be. In Romans 8, it talks about, and I think this is true of Christians, it says the whole world, Christians, we groan for the day when the Lord will return and make things right. Someday the Lord will return, and this rotting, stinky society will be no more, and we'll get to enjoy our home in heaven. So it talks about us groaning for the Lord's return, eager for the Lord's return, looking forward to His return. What a day. What a day that will be for Christians. So we don't want to be discouraged. Some of the best words of encouragement are in Romans 8, as we think about the world in which we live and trying to be salt and light and a good influence. Romans 8, verse 35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Well, no one or nothing. Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through Him who loves us. We know what the ultimate result of having to live in this rotting world, we know what the ultimate result is going to be, and nothing can separate us from the love of God. We talk about being salt and light. We will reflect the light of Jesus. In John 1, it says Jesus is the light of the world, and it is our responsibility to transfer this light to a dying and lost world. But sometimes we try to be the light. As Ryan mentioned today, sometimes there are persecutions involved. Sometimes people are not receptive. Sometimes their heart is not open. It's very much rejecting of the gospel. And so we may face some persecution. Jesus reminded us in John 15, verse 18, if the world hates you, remember the world hated Him as well. And no servant is above his master. If they persecute the Lord, they're going to persecute us as well. But we've got a responsibility to be the light, no matter come what may. We must be the light in this world. And we've got to be the salt to a decaying world and a world that smells of rottenness. In 2 Corinthians, the second chapter, verse 14, it says, but thanks be to God who always leads us in triumphal procession in Christ and through us everywhere the fragrance of the knowledge of Him. Through us, we're a fragrance to this stinky, rotten world around us. We're a fragrance of what God, of what God in Christ represent, the knowledge of Him. It says, for we are to God the aroma of Christ among those who are being saved and among those who are perishing. And so I guess the question for us is, what kind of aroma are we putting forth? Hope is a pleasant aroma, aroma that will help overcome the rotten, stinky smell of this world. There are times, I know there are times that I feel very insecure in my ability to be salt and light. Sometimes we find ourselves like, I wish I'd said this. I wish I'd done that. I wish I'd been more of a light, or I wish I'd been saltier in my influence in a particular situation. But I want us to go back to the example of Peter. I think it can always be an encouragement to us if we're up and down, or sometimes our light may flicker. Peter was a flickering light in the world. He was a great apostle. What a great man. What a great servant. But he had his moments too when he was not as salty as he should have been. When Jesus asked him, he said, Peter, who am I? He said, well, you're the Christ. You're the Son of the living God. So he was able to speak very forcefully about that. But then we see him a little bit later. He wants to join Jesus on the water, but because of his lack of faith, he sinks. And then just before the crucifixion, even after Jesus warns him or predicts, he said, Peter, you're going to deny me. You're going to deny me three times. He said, oh, no, Lord, not me. I will not do that. You're mistaken. But what does he do? He denies him three times. And so Peter's light is flickering. But there's hope. He recovers. He repents. He comes back, and what a life he lives for the Lord. What salt and light he becomes. In Acts, the second chapter, he is the one that tells the people, he said, you have crucified. You have murdered the very Son of God, the Christ. His message was powerful. The people, they're pierced, and they go, what can we do? This sin we have committed is so horrendous. What can we do? He said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And he gives them, he stands firm for the Lord. And over in Acts, the fourth chapter, I think he really shines there. They're being questioned. Peter and John do a miracle that heals a cripple. And this is when Peter really is salt and light. And they ask him about this. He says, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. He is the stone that you builders rejected, which has become the capstone. Salvation is found in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved. And when they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished and took note that these men had been with Jesus. You know, so Peter recovered. Peter went to live a life where he was salt and light. And we can do the same thing. If we have times where we don't think we're performing as we should, there's hope. We can do better. In Titus, the second chapter, as we were thinking about being salt and light, there are a couple of interesting scriptures that amaze me, and I think, but they're great, can be great examples for us today as we think about this. Titus 2, verse 9, it says, teach slaves to be subject to their masters in everything, to try to please them, not to talk back to them, and not to steal from them. So Paul's encouraging slaves to live a good life and to show that they can be trusted so that in every way they will make the teaching about God, our Savior, attractive. Now, we're certainly not in the same circumstances that slaves were, but can't we make the teaching of our Savior attractive? If Paul's encouraging slaves back in that day and time to make the teaching of our Savior attractive, how much more so can we make the teaching of our Savior attractive? We do it by a life of consistency, faithfulness, the words that we speak, Do we speak words of heaven, of salvation? Do we talk about the time that the Lord will return? Is our speech, is it pure? Is it honest? Is it trustworthy? Do we try to help others, encourage others, and share with others? These are the teachings that the Lord wants us to incorporate in our life, and they're challenging. But in order for our words to be effective, our lives must be consistent with those words. So we have to watch our language, watch the things we say, how we talk to others, watch our deeds to make sure they're consistent with how we live, and to realize if the slaves of that time, we'd be able to make the teaching of our Savior attractive. The second main point of our lesson, is what we want to talk about, is as we obey God and as we try to be salt and light, to make sure we're doing this for God's glory and not for our own. So we have to ask ourselves and search our hearts, what are the motives for what we're doing, the kind of life that we're living, the things that we're teaching and doing? There are temptations to try to bring glory to ourselves sometimes. And so we have to watch that, watch our consistency and watch our humility and what we're really trying to do and how we're really trying to serve God. We don't want to confuse actual righteousness with shows of righteousness. We want to be sincere in all we're doing. If we're going to be salt and light and make the teaching of our Savior attractive, we've got to be consistent in what we're doing. It talks about in Matthew 6. In verse 3, he says, "But when you give to the needy, do not let your left hand know what your right hand is doing, so that your giving may be in secret. And then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you openly." It's important. It's important. Humility. Let others, not to do things for personal glory, but to have an attitude of humility. In Philippians 2, it gives us the greatest example we could ever follow. It talks about the example of Jesus. He humbled himself for the cross. And it says, you know, in Philippians, this is our attitude ought to be like him, where we humble ourselves in sacrifice and in service. And our third main point of our lesson this morning is we're to live purposely. What's the purpose of our lives as we live from day to day? What is the purpose of our lives? If we look in Matthew, the 7th chapter, it says we're to bear fruit. And that's how we're recognized. People are recognized. They recognize us as Christians by the fruit that we bear, what the fruit of our lives. That's how we're recognized. And then in verse 21, it says, remember now, not everyone that says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but it's he who does the will of the Father. So it's important to live our lives purposefully, honestly, humbly. And he says in, further in verse 24 of Matthew 7, therefore everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like the wise man who built his house on a rock. And so what is your purpose? What's the purpose of your life? Is it to bear fruit? Is your goal in your life to be a good tree bearing fruit for God? And so if we look at the example of Jesus, did a lot of great things in his life. He was one of the 12. But his heart, you know, his heart was dark. His heart was not right, and it led him astray. Another thing that's important to think of is as we talk about obedience to God is not just the outward appearance. And look at the example of the Pharisees. You know, chapter 23 of Matthew is a scathing report of the Pharisees and how they lived. And it's a warning to us as well about where are our hearts as we try to be salt and light. Where are our hearts as we try to serve the Lord? It says in Matthew 23 and verse 3, the problem the Pharisees had is that they didn't practice what they preach. And so isn't that a question for us as well? Do we practice what we preach? And then he uses an analogy that is just so nails the description of what he's trying to say. He said, they're like whitewashed tombs, but on the inside, they're full of dead men's bones. So as we're trying to be salt and light, what's our purpose? What's our goal? Is it are our motives honest? Are we willing to serve the Lord and sacrifice for Him? So as we kind of wrap things up this morning, I wanted to go to the book of 2 Corinthians. I think it gets a real good description of what our lives as salt and life could be. Yet another analogy, which is, I think, a great example for us to follow. In chapter 5 of 2 Corinthians, it talks about us being ambassadors for Christ. Now, we all understand what an ambassador is in governmental terms. You know, we have ambassadors to China, to England. And what's their job? Their job is to go to these foreign countries and explain to these people, this is what the United States of America, this is what we stand for. This is what we believe. These are our policies. This is how we conduct ourselves. And so just as that ambassador, in a governmental sense, serves our country, we're an ambassador for Christ. And again, it's another analogy, just like the salt and the light. A few verses I wanted to highlight, though, in chapter 5, it says, since then we know what it is to fear the Lord, we try to persuade men. We understand what it is to fear God, to respect God. We understand that there is a day coming when we'll be judged by the way we lived our lives. So because we understand this, that is a part of our motivation to be salt and light and to reach other people. In verse 14, it says, for Christ's love compels us because we're convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. So not only are we motivated to be salt and light and ambassadors, but we're motivated by the love of Christ. It compels us. We've experienced the love of Christ. We've experienced salvation. We understand it. We understand that heaven is the home for those who are faithful to God. And so knowing Christ's love, it compels us to be salt and light and ambassadors. In verse 17, it says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature, a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. So we have to ask ourselves, are we living as if we're new, a new creation? And this is all from God who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. So why do we need to be salt and light? Because God gave us the very ministry of reconciliation, reconciling people to God. That God was reconciling the world to himself in Christ, not counting men's sins against them, and he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore ambassadors as though God were making his appeal through us. He is literally doing that. As we spread the word, as we're salt and light, God is making his appeal to the world through us, his very servants. We're his very vessels. So he says, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. So we're ambassadors. We're the representatives of Christ on earth. It is literally Christ is appealing to the world through us. Be reconciled. Be saved. And then the start of chapter 6, it says, this today is the day of salvation. Today is the time to start being ministers of reconciliation. We don't want to put it off. Today is the day of salvation. So I've got a few suggestions I want to close with this morning as we wrap up the lesson. Suggestions on how we can be salt and light, ambassadors the aroma of Christ in this world. And I just run through these briefly, and hopefully you can use some of them. First of all, I'd say acknowledge to others your thankfulness to God for His providence and care. You know, Ryan mentioned it's hard sometimes in the workplace to say much about Christianity. Sometimes you can, sometimes you can't. But I have used COVID-19 in our workplace to try to bring some glory to God. I tell our workers, I say, you know, first of all, we all, you know, the governor declared construction workers to be essential workers from the very beginning. Our workers were very concerned about that, but we had to go forward, and they did. They did an admirable job. So I tell them, God was mindful of us. We got through it. A few people got sick, but not severely. And more importantly, more thankfully, we got through it. We still have a company. We still have a way to make a living. So many others, they lost everything. So I say, we need to be so thankful. God was mindful of us, and He got us through this time. Ask people if you can pray for them. When you meet people in the workplace, just say, if they're struggling with something, say, can I pray for you? And then pray for them. You know, Ephesians 3 said God is able to do more than we can ever think or imagine for people through prayer. Send people cards, notes, emails, showing your concern for what they're going through. That's another way we can be ambassadors for Christ. I think it might be great sometimes if you just pass along a scripture to someone. Could you jot it down and say, I know you're struggling. I found this scripture to be helpful to me. I hope you'll take it and read it. I hope it'll help you as it's helped me. Again, as I mentioned earlier, because the thing about scripture, sometimes we can't say the right things, but if they can read scripture, it has some power that we just don't have. It can pierce their heart. It can pierce a hard heart and help them to see the power of God. And finally, I'd encourage you to be one of the sheep. In Matthew 25, there's a great lesson there. It's a final judgment scene where the writer talks about all the people of the world being gathered together, and the Lord is there, and the angels are there, and he divides the folks up into two groups, the sheep and the goats, the sheep on his right hand and the goats on the left. And in verse 34, then the king will say to those on his right, come you who are blessed by my Father, and take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger and you invited me in. I needed clothes and you clothed me. I was sick and you looked after me. I was in prison and you came to visit me. So obviously the sheep, they were being ambassadors. The aroma of Christ. They were being salt and light. What's interesting in verse 37, though, of course, we would all think, well, now if we saw the Lord in need, any of us would stop and help him, obviously. But the sheep say, Lord, when did we ever see you like this? And see, they were just acting naturally as salt and light and ambassadors. They were doing it to people who were not necessarily worthy, but they just did it because that's what they're supposed to do. That's how they're supposed to, that's how Christians are supposed to act. And they said, Lord, we never saw you like that. And he said, no. And he said, when you did it to one of the least of these, my brothers, it was as if you did it to me. So I would encourage us as we close the lesson this morning, let's try to be salt and light and the aroma of Christ. And let's be like the sheep and be willing to help others. This is what gives glory to God. When sometimes if we can't speak a sermon, if we can, through our actions, we can communicate great things about our Lord. So I'll just say this. I don't want to be a goat. Nope. As the song says. Hey, thanks for being here this morning. We're so grateful to have you here, have you back. So grateful to see so many friendly faces that we've missed for so long, and glad to be getting back together. We can encourage each other as fellow sheep to do all we can to glorify God in our daily lives. It's very encouraging to be around others. We kind of come in here each week, and as a team, we get our weekly pep talk and ready out in the world and do battle again. So I hope this will be a good day of encouragement for you. Have a great week. Be salt and light. We love you. Y'all take care.